Fine. So, what our plan today is to cover three topics. Basically, the first one is classes and objects. The second one is constructors and destructors. And the last one is operator overloading. So, there are three topics to be covered today. And by the end of today's lecture, we will finish half of module number two also. So by finishing constructors and destructors, we'll finish module number one. And at the end of this lecture, we will be finishing like half of module number two. And then we'll have only one topic remaining, which is the inheritance part. Okay. So I don't know how much time we will be able to, like, how long it will take. It might take almost, I think, 1.5 hours to finish our topics. Okay, so if it is taking that much time, we will try to have a break of something like 10 minutes in between, and we'll continue after that. Right? Okay, so let me. So yesterday we had looked upon the some basic things about classes. Okay, so today we are going to see how we can implement a class in our program. Okay, so for that, let me just go through the slides two or three, and then okay. So this is classes and objects. So classes are an expanded version of structure. So we have seen structure yesterday, where we see that you can define multiple different types of variables inside a structure. And classes are actually an expanded version where, along with variables, you can also have functions. So in classes, you have variables and functions as members. So you, when you define something inside a class, it is called as a member. It can be a function or it can be a variable. And class is a way to bind data and its associated functions together. We'll see how that is happening. A class declaration describes the type and scope of its member. We'll also see that. The class function definition describe how the class is implemented. Okay, we'll see all of these things. An example of a class, as I said last time, is a car. So there are many cars with different names and brand, but all of them will share some common properties. Like all of them will have wheels, speed limit, mileage range, etc. Okay, so as I said earlier, when you do a programming, it might not be a small program to add two numbers, but it might be a big program to control the car. So in that case, you need to know all the parameters of a car. So your car itself is a class, and you can have all the functionalities of car defined inside the class. So here, car is a class, and wheels, speed limits, mileage are their properties. Okay. Okay, so let's look at how a class is implemented in programming. Okay, so let me just share my entire screen so that you'll be able to see my ID. I hope you can see my IDE. It shows the structure program that we have written yesterday. Okay. So let's start with classes and objects in C++. Okay. So as always, you start with hashing load IOstream using name space std. We have talked about why do we want to write these two things in our first class. Okay, and then you have the main program. Okay, and the main will return zero. This is what a template of your C++ program is. So today, what we are going to do is, let us define a class. For example, let us say I want to have a class called as box. Okay, or let's say I want to, let me define a class called as circle. That will be more easy. Okay. Now, what are the parameters of the circle? They are only radius, because a circle is defined everything by its radius. And what are the functions for a circle? One is area, other is perimeter, right? So in a circle, you have a parameter called as radius, and the functionalities or the properties of a circle are defined by area and parameter and perimeter. So this parameter is actually your variable inside the class. Okay, this is only an example. I am not saying that circle is the only class that you can define. So I am just saying that this is an example of class. Okay, so the parameter is radius, which is the variable inside the class. And the functions of this variable is called as member variables. So whatever variable you declare inside the class is called as a member variable. And the functions is actually the functions inside the class. And this is called as member functions. This is all there in the slide. So we just skim through the slide after we look at the program. Okay. Fine. Now let's define the circle. Okay. So you say this is class definition. When you define the circle, first you write the keyword called as class. So this is a keyword which is similar to that of structure. Okay. Just like we have struct in structure, we have class in class definition. And then you give the name of the class, which is circle. Okay. Then you start a brace, end a brace. Fine. So this is how you define a class. You have a class keyword, you have a name of the class. In my case, it is called as circle. Now I want to define radius, I want to calculate area, I want to calculate perimeter. So since radius is a member variable, I can say plot radius. Okay, so this is actually the member variable named radius of data type plot, because radius can be like 1.1, 1.2, 1.3, etc., 2.1, 0.1, etc. It cannot be negative. Okay, this is called as a member variable. Now, then I want to define a function in the class which calculates area and parameter, perimeter. Okay, so I'm going to do something like this. I'm going to define the function. The definition of a function is same as that we have seen earlier. You will have a return type. Area can be floating value, so float. I will say area. And you can calculate area as area value, or I could say circle area, is equal to 3.14 into radius pi r square, which is radius into radius, which is the area. Okay, and I'm returning the area. Right? So this is called as the member function. Where you have defined a function called as area. It is not taking any input arguments. Okay, so no input arguments it is taking. no input arguments. Okay, the name of the member function is area. Return type is plot. Okay, and here you are calculating the area. Okay, so here circle area is a variable which you need to define inside. So I define float circle area, because unless you define the circle area, it will not be compiling. So you define the circle area inside the function. It will be a float value because it can have take decimal places. Once you calculate the area, you return the value to the caller of the function. Okay, so we'll see perimeter after this. So let me see how I can access all these things. Okay, so just like you in your structure, you have created a member variable, or you have created an object. You need to create an object for this class. How will you create an object for the class? You say the object name, which is circle, and sorry, you say the class name, which is circle, and you say the object name. So how will, so creating creating object is class name space object name. This is how you create an object. So the class name is this one, which is circle. And you create a new object name, which is called as C1. So I can create any number of objects. I can create C2, C3, C4, etc. And the concept of object is same as that of structure. Whenever you create a new object, it always occupies a new memory space, because of which both the objects are totally independent. Okay. Now let us try to see whether I can access the radius, because here the radius value is not set. I want to set a radius to a circle. Okay, so if I do this, c1 dot radius is equal to 2. Okay, so if you remember in structure, you after creating the object, you put a dot and you access the variable. You can just access it directly. This is how you access in structure also. Now if I do this, let's see what is happening. See, it shows me an error saying that float circle radius is private, and this is an error. Means, if you remember structure and accessing variables, you know that this is a valid statement. It didn't give me an error in the structure. But when you define that in the class, and you try to access radius, it is saying that circle colon colon, which is called as scope resolution operator, circle colon colon radius is private, which means that the radius which is defined inside the class circle is private. Now what do you mean by private? We'll see that in a minute. Okay, but the important thing is you cannot access the variable inside the class circle directly. Okay, then let me try if I can access area. Let's see whether I can access area. So I can write c1 dot area. This is a function call, right? Okay, so similar to you have access radius as c1 dot radius, you can access the function by dot operator, object, and the function call. So this is how you access the member function inside the class. Means you have object name dot function name in bracket. If you have input arguments, you should view the input arguments. Okay, this is how you access the function. Now if I compile this again, let's see what is happening. It again showed me another. It says plot circle colon colon area is private. Now what is private? It is happening every time. Like why it is complaining that there is something called as a private thing? Okay, so this is what is happening. Let me just tell you this. In a class, let me write it to the top. In a class, there is something called as access specifiers. Means you cannot access all the variables and functions inside the class at your will. You cannot access it. The programmer needs to specify which all member functions and member variables can be accessed inside the class using access specifiers. Okay. Now, there are three types of access specifiers. One, private. If you declare a member function or member variable as private, you cannot, let me stress it, cannot access it from outside the class. But you can access it from anywhere inside the class. Okay, that is called as private. Two, the second access specifier is called as public, which means if you declare a member function or member variable as public, you can access it from anywhere, let me put it in the next line, from anywhere in the program, both outside and inside the class. Okay. So there is something called as access specifiers, which can be of three types. There is third one called as protected, which we will not look into it now. We will look into it when we look at inheritance. Okay, I'll just mention that. But as protected. Okay. So there is something called as access specifiers, using which you will define which all variables can be accessed from inside the class and which all variables can be accessed from outside the class. Okay, so by default all the variables and functions are private by default. Okay, now what do you mean by accessing? You see, when I did c1.radius is equal to 2, you cannot, it was saying error because you are trying to access radius from here. Okay, so by default everything is private. So how will you define an access specifier? You say private colon. So whatever comes under this private or whatever comes after private will be private. Okay, now if I want to say something is public, I can just say public colon. So here radius is private because it is under private and it cannot be accessed from outside the class. Okay. Here the area is public. So I can access it outside the class. So this function, the function area is public and can be accessed from outside the class. Okay, so let's see what is happening. If I now do area like this, and if I try to compile, you see that there is no errors because I can access area. But if I do radius here and try to compile, it says it is private. So all the private things cannot be accessed outside the class. Outside the class is outside this starting braces and this ending braces. You cannot access it from outside. But you can access it from inside the class, because if you see, this radius is being used here also. That is inside the class, so that you can access. Okay, so let's try to, now how will you now set the value of area? Because you cannot access radius, right? Unless you set a radius value. For example, let's say I want to set my radius value is equal to 2. How will you set the radius value? For that, you can create another public function, void set radius. Okay, and then you say, and you pass an argument called as radius, and you set this radius is equal to that value. Okay, since set radius is a public function, you can access it from here. So I can say c1 dot, there is already set radius. I am setting my radius to, let's say, 2.1. Okay. So let's try to execute. Sorry, there's a queue here. So it says there are no errors. Okay. Now let's see what is the value of the set radius. Okay, let me put in debug mode. Let's see whether I'm not sure whether I can see the value of radius. Okay. Fine. So when I call set radius and into the function, you see that it jumped into the set radius function. Now, before executing this, the value of radius is 0. Now, when I execute that, you see that the value of radius has changed. Okay. It's 2.099 because it is float. It might have some precision issues. Okay. And then once I go to the next line, it go to the next line and exit. So what is happening is when I call set radius, it will jump into the set radius function. It will set the argument which I pass from here to the radius, and this is actually the private member function which we couldn't access from outside, but we are now accessing it using this function. Okay, so we are not directly writing the value of radius from outside the class, but we are trying to write the value of radius from using another function which is a public function. Okay, now I can calculate the area. I can say C1 dot, or I say plot area, circle area is equal to C1 dot area. Okay, and if I print, circle area is, I do circle area, will print the area. So here what I'm doing is I'm creating a new variable called as circle area. Now I'm calling c1 dot area. Now when I call c1 dot area, it will go inside. It has already the radius value which we set here. So 3.14 into radius into radius, that will be your new circle area. It will be copied to this variable, and this variable, the value of this variable will be returning back, and it will be copied to this variable. And when I print this variable, you'll get the value of the circle. So let's compile this. Let us debug. Okay, so let me put this also to watch. So you have circle area here, radius here. Let me go step by step. Okay, so into the function, it went inside, the value of radius is set, it came back, it has declared circle area, and it is assigned a value 0. You go to inside the function, it went inside the area, okay, and then it calculated the area. So if you look at this variable, it has already calculated the area 13.847. okay, now when I go to the next line, it comes back and you see the variable inside the main function, the value of this is copied because you are returning back the circle area. So value inside the circle area will be copied to circle area, and when you go to the next line, it will print the value. So circle area is 13.8474. okay, so this is how you create a class, define private variables, define public functions, define public variables, and define private functions. Okay, so all these things are the inside the program. Okay, so let me do one more thing. So you can have private functions also. Okay, I can say plot get radius. I can do something like this, and I can return the value of radius. Okay, so this is a private function, cannot be accessed from outside. Okay, I can have public variables, for example plot perimeter. I can have this. Okay, so this is a public variable that can be accessed from outside. Okay, so I can say that parameter is equal to 2 into 3.14 into radius. I can do this. Okay, so if I do something like this, plot perimeter is equal to c1 dot perimeter, and you see out perimeter. Okay, if you do this, you can see that it will not show me an error, because let's put this perimeter so we will not have confusion. So you see that since perimeter is a public variable, because of public access specifier, you can directly access perimeter without any function with c1 dot perimeter. So if I do compile, okay, remove the semicolon. There is some warning, that is fine. Okay, so if I run this, you see the perimeter is 0 because I haven't set the radius. Okay, so I can write this in a different way, say, or something like this. to see the perimeter is 4, which means that you accessed directly the public variable perimeter and you could print the result. Okay, so the concept of class is simple, that you can have a class, it's a keyword, there is class name, you have three different access specifiers, private and public and protected. Protected we'll see later. So if it is a private member function or a private member variable, you cannot access this private members from outside the class, that is, for example, from this main function, for example. Okay, but you can access it from anywhere inside the class. If it is a public access specifier, you can have either member variables or member functions as public. If you declare something as public, you can access it from anywhere inside the program. It need not be a class, it need not be a function, anywhere inside the program you can access something like this: set radius, area, parameter, etc. Okay, whenever you declare a class, this is called a class definition. You need to create an object of the class by using the class name and the object name, and using this object name only you can access any of the variables or functions inside the class. Okay, this is what classes and objects is. Okay, there is one more thing. So let's say I want to define this outside the class. Okay, so in that case, what I will do is I'll just say float area here, and I can outside the class, that is after this closing braces, I can say float name of the class, scope resolution operator, area, and I can define it here. When this is also fine. For example, if I want to define it outside the class, I can do it something like this. Okay, so I declare the class name here. That is very important. You cannot do without declaration. So you declare the class name here in the same format. So declare the function name here in the same format as that you need the function. Then go outside the class. Then you say return type class name, scope resolution operator, function name, and you define the function here. Even this is fine. Okay, this also will do same way as that we have done previously. Okay, so this is regarding classes and objects. Do you have any doubts on this topic that I have just mentioned? Okay, this is a very important concept, because all through the C++ and even for Java, we'll be using classes and objects. And unless you understand this concept, it will be very difficult for you to understand anything further. Should understand the concept of class, you should understand the concept of access specifiers, private, public, and protected. Where, from where you can access all these variables, from where you can, we cannot access all these variables, you should understand the concept. Okay, so before going to the next talk, okay, I'll do one more thing. I will look at something called as friend functions. Okay, so friend functions means, like, for example, the private members cannot be accessed outside the class. Or in other words, non-member functions does not have access to private data of a class. For example, radius cannot be accessed from outside the class. But if you define a function as a friend of this class, then using that function, you can access all the private members. Okay, so let me write it down. So private members cannot be accessed outside the class. Okay, that is first point. But if you define a function as friend of this class, then using this friend function, you can access the private members of the class. And remember, friend functions are not, stress it again, not member functions of the class. Okay, so here set radius and area are member functions. Okay, but you can define a function outside the class, which is a friend of this class, using which you can access the private members. Okay, so how will you do this? You say friend is a keyword, void get radius. Okay, you can have input arguments, or let's say get radius means that you should have a float. Okay, you can have input arguments. So here currently I'm not giving input arguments. Okay, and semicolon, and you define, this is friend function declaration. In declaration, you will just say there is a function somewhere else in the code. You haven't defined it, okay? And you define the friend function here. Okay, so in that case, what you do is you say float get radius, okay? And using which objects you need to access this. So usually you will pass this circle okay, so this is actually means you are passing an input argument whose data type is that of the class. Okay, so basically you are passing an object to this friend function. So you see, you put circle, sir, and you can say return sir dot radius. Let me see if this compiles. Okay, so if I want to get the radius, I can just call, let's say define circle radius as a new variable. I say circle radius is equal to, I can call this function get radius, and I can pass this object C1. Okay, so what it does is, now when you pass C1 as an object, the whole class is passed to this function. So this sir will have all the variables and functions defined inside the class. So when I do sir.radius, whatever radius I have set using C1 will be returned back. Okay, let me print this also. See out. So, so they call it. Okay, then let's run this to 0.1. So you see that C1 has returned back whatever, or this get radius, which is not a function of the class, but a friend function of the class, has returned me back the actual radius set to the private variable radius. So this radius is actually a private variable. This we have accessed using the friend function, and I could do anything using that variable. But this is called as a friend function. So friend functions are something which you can access the private members of a class if you define that function as a friend of the class. Okay. I hope you have understood the friend function concept. You see, this friend function is not a member function of the class circle. That is very, very important. Friend function is a function that you have defined outside the main as usual, but inside the class we have defined it as a friend function, because of which you can access the member variables, private member variables from inside the class. Fine. Okay, so let me go to the presentation. So that we'll just go through the presentation once. I hope you can see my presentation. So class declaration consists of class name, private and public access pairs. You can have variable declaration, function declaration in both the categories. Okay. So this is the class, which is the keyword. Class name is the name of the class. Private and public are the access specifiers. And you can have private member variables, private member functions, public member functions. Object is an instance of the class. So when a class is defined, there is no memory being allocated, but when it is instantiated, memory is allocated. Okay. So when you want to access a data member of the class, you put object dot operator and the variable name or a function name, which is public. Okay. You cannot access it using private access specifiers. So this is one example where you see there's a class called as geeks. There's an object which is being created called as obj1, and geek name is public. So obj1.geek name is equal to Avi, and you can print the name. So all these are public, because of which you can access the public access specifier, which I told earlier that you can access anything from inside the class using public access specifier. For example, public double radius, double compute area, and you create an object called as obj for circle, and obj.radius, you can set it because radius is public. Now, instead of public, if you change to private, what do you observe? Now, private access specifier, if you specify, then the variables cannot be accessed outside the class. Okay. For example, here radius is made as private. Now, if I compile this, you see that it showed me an error showing that radius is private and cannot be accessed outside the class. Very, very important. That is, if an access specifier is not specified, it will be taken as private. So if you don't specify an access specifier here, it will be taken as private. So here, although compute area is public, there is no access specifier specified here, because of which radius is private. Now, this is a member function. This is defined inside the class. Okay. So this member function is defined inside the class. I can define it outside the class by using return type, name of the class, scope resolution operator, and the function name. So you should specify the class name with scope resolution operator to define the class outside. You can have member function inside another member function. This is called as nesting. Okay. So square num is a private member function. Cube num is another public member function. Display num is private member function, public member function. But inside display disp underscore num, you are calling square underscore num and cube underscore num. That means you are nesting the member functions. Okay, so from inside a member function, you can call other member functions. Now, friend function is a standalone function, which is not a member of any class. And but you can use it to access the private variables. And the syntax is something like this. Inside the class, you declare the friend function, and outside the class, you define the friend function. And you should remember that the friend function cannot be called using the object of that class. So if you remember in our code, we have just called the function. We haven't used any object. Okay, so it can be invoked as a normal function. So example is this. You have a class called as box. It has a parameter called as width. The friend function is to print the width. So it will accept the object of the class, which is box. Okay. And then the function is defined outside the class, in which you are actually accessing the width, which is the private member variable of the box. Okay, so you are accessing the private member variable of the box, and you call the friend function without the object box directly, so that it will give me the output. Okay. Fine. So that's about classes and objects, and you can answer some of these questions. I will put it in the slide so that you will understand what all these things are. Okay, there are some programming exercises that you will be having as your assignment for next week. Okay, so this is regarding classes. So we have finished one topic for today. Let's move on to the next topic, which is called as constructors and destructors. Okay, and after that we will take a break, and then we will go to the operator overload. Right. Do you have any questions regarding whatever we have covered till now? If you have any questions, you can talk to me or you can put in chat. Whatever. Okay, so I believe there are no questions. Fine. Then let's go to constructors and destructors. Okay, now constructors and destructors are, I think, pretty much easy topic, but they have always asked questions from constructors and destructors in the semester examinations. Okay, it's very easy, it's nothing too much into it, but only thing you need to understand is its concept. Why do we need a constructor? Okay, so the reason behind why we need a constructor is that we need to initialize, or we need to give a value to all the private variables of a class. We cannot access private variables of a class from outside the class. So we need to initialize, we need to set a value to all the private variables inside the class. And for that, we are using constructors. Constructors are something which constructs the value of a variable. And destructors are something which destructs the value of a variable. Okay. And the constructor is called at the start of the program, or at wherever you create an object, a constructor is called. And the important part is the name of the constructor is same as the class name. The constructor is invoked or called whenever an object of the associated class is created. Constructor constructs the data of value of data of members of the class. So this is why we need constructors. Okay. So let's do a simple program. Okay. Okay, so I think instead of complicating this, let's remove this and let's start the topic as constructors. Okay, so hash include IO stream using namespace std. So our int main रिटर्न जीरो। सो लेट अस डिफाइन ए क्लास कॉल्ड एज, व्हाट यू कॉल ए क्लास लाइक सीटी कंस्ट्रक्ट। ओके, सो द क्लास नेम इज कंस्ट्रक्ट सीटी। ओके, लेट्स assume there are two private variables which is of integer type a comma b. Okay, and let's be public which will set the value of a comma b in the a val comma in b val, in which I am going to set a equal to a val and b equal to b val. Okay. And let me have one more function which says int get a value which will return me the value of a. Okay, and inside the main function I'm going to create an object of ct which is called as c1. Okay, and if I do c1 dot get value and if I print this, let's see what is the value that I am getting. Okay, so here I am not initializing a and b to any value. Okay, and I am just saying I want to know what is the value that a and b has. If I run this, and if I run, you see the value of a is 0. But I don't want the value of a to be 0 when I run this. I want the value of a to be like 10 and b to be like 12 when I start the program. What will I do? So for that, you will create something called as a constructor. Okay, the name of the constructor is same as the name of the class. So ct is the class, ct is the name of the constructor. Okay, then you give brackets and I say a is 12, b is 10. Okay, and remember this one, there is no return type for the constructor. Two, the name of the constructor is same as that of the name of the class. Very important. Okay, so using constructor, and third one, the constructor is called when you create the object. Okay, let's see what that means. So this is the constructor, and these are three important points of the constructor. And constructor is called when you create the object. So this is a statement you in which you are creating the object for the class CT. So when you create this object, it will automatically call the constructor. So let's see that. Okay, I hope I can show you that using this. Let's see, let's try. You see, instead of going, when I clicked next line, instead of going to this line, it went directly to CT. Okay, so before executing this, the value of A was 0, the value of B was 0. Okay, Now, when I execute this, now A become 12, B become 10, it will exit and go to the next line, which is where you get the value. So when I execute that, you can see that it has printed the value of A is 12 and quit. Okay. So when this constructor is object is created, the constructor is called and it will move to the constructor. Fine. So let me do one more thing. Let me create another object, CT C2. Okay, let's see what is happening now. Okay, so I put in debug. I go to next line. It called the constructor A equal to 12, B equal to 10. It came back. Now it is going to execute the creation of C2. When I click this, it will again go to the constructor. Why? Because you are creating another object here. So there is a creation of second object. Yeah, because of which the constructor will be called. So whenever you create an object, the constructor will be called. Whether you create the object in the first statement, second statement, end of the program, wherever you create, this constructor will be called. And the constructor is mainly for initializing the variables, particularly the private variables inside the function. Okay. Now, this constructor is called as default constructor, which doesn't have any input arguments. Okay. So if the constructor doesn't have any input arguments, for example, this, it is called as a default constructor. I can define another constructor. We say CT int aval int bval, and inside the constructor I can say A equal to aval, B equal to bval, and this is called as parameterized constructor, where you have input arguments for the constructor to initialize the variables. This is called as parameterized constructor. Okay, so when you call the parameterized constructor, let me remove C2, I can just say, or C1 of object in bracket, the value with which you need to initialize A and B, or the value which is being passed to A val and B val. So I can say 100, 200. Okay. So if I do this, you can see that when the C1 object is created, it will call the parameterized constructor because you are giving the parameters here. It will not call this constructor because of the parameters which is being passed. So let me show you how. Debug. When I go to the next line, you see instead of executing CT, it has come to CT with parameters because you are passing the parameters here. And when I go to the next line, A is initialized with 100, B is initialized with 200, and enter and finish. Okay. So depending on if I create C1, C2, that is without parameter, then you can see that the C1, when you create C1, it will go to the parameterized constructor. It has initialized the value. when you go to C2, it has gone to the default constructor without parameters, and it has initialized the value. Okay, because in C1, you are specifying the parameters because of which it is going to the parameterized constructor. In C2, you are not specifying any parameters because of which it is going to the default constructor. Okay, so these two are very, very important: parameterized constructor and default constructor. Now there is a third type of constructor, which is called as copy constructor. Okay, so let me write a copy constructor. I can say CT. The syntax is as follows. This is called as copy constructor. CP const, this is a constant. It is a class which is being passed with some name CT1. Okay. Inside this, what you are going to do is we're going to copy the values of CT1 to the values of A and B. So I can say A is equal to CT1 dot A, B is equal to CT2 dot B. So what I'm doing is, in CT1, I might have already set the values of A and B. I'm copying the values of A and B of the object CT1 to the current object. Variables in the current object. Let's write this program. Okay. So I can say C1 is 100, 200, and C2 is equal to C1. I'm doing this. So if you look at this statement, you are actually copying the values of C1 to C2. Right? So let's look at how this works. Sorry, this is C1. Okay. Let me put a breakpoint here. Let me put in debug. Okay. So when I go into the function, you see C1 has A, B, something like this. Let me put in more accurate way. C1 dot A. C1 dot B. C2 dot A. C2 dot B. I don't know whether this will work, but let me try. You see, C1 dot A is 100, C1 dot B is 200. Fine? Because you have initialized them using the copy constructor, using the parameters constructor, this one. Now, when I go to this line, if you go into the function, you see that instead of when you C2 is equal to C1 has the statement, because of which it has go to the copy constructor. Now, the copy constructor has CT1 currently, which is the C1 dot A. So because C2 equal to C1 means this C1 is passed as the argument CT1. And then if you go to the next line, you see that C2 dot A become 100, C2 dot B become 200. Because of why? Because you have passed C1 as an argument to this copy constructor, CT1. So CT1 dot A is 100, CT1 dot B is 200. You have copied CT1 to C2 dot A and C2 dot B, because of which this has been happening. This is called as copy constructor. So these are the three different type of constructors which we use in C++. And this has been asked multiple times in your end semester examination, the three different types of constructors. constructors and with an example. Okay, this is called as a constructor. Now let's look at something called as destructor. Destructor is the simplest of them all, which destructs or deletes an object. A destruct function is called when the function ends, program ends, or some kind of a deletion is happening. A destructor cannot take any arguments, cannot return any arguments. So destructor means you have a, the syntax is like this: tilde class name brackets. For example, in our case, it is tilde ct bracket, and inside this you can do whatever things. For example, I can say a is equal to 0, b is equal to 0. This is called as a destructor. So let me just remove this. Okay, let's see how it is getting executed. Compile, program, debug. So object is created. So when I go into the function, the constructor is called, the values are copied, comes back, you get the value, return 0. After this, usually after return 0, it will go to this bracket and end the program. But instead, it will go to the constructor, because you are going to end the program here. The program is going to get ended. So before ending the program, the object will be destroyed. So to destroy the object, it will go to the destructor, it will deinitialize everything. So whatever you do here is called as deinitialization into the function and end. Okay, so destructor comes when you actually going to stop the execution of the program. Fine, that is regarding destructor. So we'll just run through the slides and then we'll take a break. So constructors, you see that there's a class called as construct. It has constructor name construct itself, where you are initializing the values. And whenever you create an object for construct with object name C, the constructor is called. Type of constructors, default constructor that we have already seen. Parameterized constructor, in which, let's say you have a class called as point. In the point, you are accepting two input arguments, y1 and x1, which are going to initialize the variables x and y. This is called as a parameterized constructor. Okay. And when you create an object with passing the values inside the brackets, the parameterized constructor is called and the values will be initialized. The last one is the copy constructor. So your class is sample copy constructor. The sample copy constructor will have the same name as of the class, but it will accept a constant object. This is called as value by reference. And it is used to copy the values of this object to the current object. So whenever you do object 2 is equal to object 1, the copy constructor is called by reference, it will copy the values. Okay. And destructors are when the program ends, the function ends, and it is called whenever the object is going to get destroyed. Okay, so syntax is tilde class name. So for example, the class is called as hello world, and the destructor will have a tilde and hello world. It's called as destructor definition. You can do anything inside the destructor. Okay, fine. So you have some questions to answer, true or false, and there's a programming exercise. Okay, so this will be your assignment tomorrow. Okay, so if you don't have any questions, we'll take a break for 10 minutes. We'll come back at 11:20 and we will do operator overloading. Okay. Right. So we'll take a break of 10 minutes. We'll come back at 11:20. Okay, so we will go to the last topic, which is operator overloading. So we are actually going to module number two. We have finished module number one. So let me just the slides and then we'll go to the program. So let's see what an operator overloading is. So normally you know an operator, what an operator. For example, plus is an operator. It says that if you have plus sign, whatever there is on the left side and whatever there is on the right side, you should add. Sum it up and get the result. That is called as a plus. Similarly, you have minus, division, multiplication, and you have logical operators like and, or, XOR, etc. You have a lot of operators other than C++. Each of these operators can be given a different meaning. For example, when you say 2 plus 3, this basically you are adding 2 and 3 to give 5. If you have two objects of classes, let's say C1 and C2, and then you say C1 plus C2. If you do that, what does it mean? Because you cannot add an object to get a result, right? So you can define what that addition means if you're adding two objects, or if you're adding two functions, what that plus means. And that is called as operator overloading. And operator overloading can be given to any number of operators, okay? So the C++ has the ability to provide the operators with a special meaning for that. For a data type. This is called as operator overload. Okay. So the syntax is like this. You have a return type, class name, operator, and the operator symbol. For example, if it is plus, OP is plus. If it is minus, OP is minus. Okay. Now, what are steps for overloading? You create a class that defines the data type that is to be used in overloading operation. Declare the function. This just now we have seen the previous slide, the operator function in the public part of the class. It can be a friend function also, and define the operator to implement the required operations. All these operators can be overloaded: plus, minus, star, slash, percentage, power, ampersand, or tilde, less than, greater than, less than, equal to, plus, plus, minus, minus, ampersand, delete, new. All these operators can be overloaded, okay? But there are four or five operators which you cannot overload. Those are dot, you cannot overload, dot star, you cannot overload, scope resolution operator, which is colon, colon, you cannot overload, size of operator cannot be overloaded, and conditional question mark operator cannot be overloaded. So these are the five operators which you cannot overload. Okay. Now let's start with overloading a unary operator. So what do you mean by a unary operator? Plus is a binary operator, which means that plus has two operands, one on the left side and one on the right side. That is called as a binary operator. Okay. So let me go to the programming part. Let me delete everything. Okay. So we are going to look at operator overloading. The first thing we are going to look at is, let me just machine load the your stream using namespace std int main. The first thing that we are going to look at is ओवरलोडिंग ए यूनरी ऑपरेटर. तो व्हाट मीन बाय यूनरी ऑपरेटर? फॉर एग्जांपल, लेट्स से आई हैव अ प्लस, व्हेन यू से 2 + 3 यू हैव ऑपरेंड्स एज 2 and 3. बेसिकली देयर आर टू ऑपरेंड्स. This is called as a binary operator because binary means two. Okay. Similarly, if I do something like this -3, okay, so the operand is only one, which is 3. This is called as a unary operator because you have only one operand, which is 3. Similarly, you can have something like this. +3. So this plus is a unary operator, or you can define a variable. For example, let's say int a equal to 0, and you can say a++. This is another operator, or a-. This is another operator. Okay, or a. Yeah. So these are called as unary operator. This is called as increment operator. This is called as decrement operator. This is unary minus, this is unary plus. These are all called as unary operators. So you can overload this unary operator. Let's see with a simple program. Okay. Let us define a class called as distance. Okay. Now the distance has two variables, private variables. One is called as int feet and int inches, all are private. Okay. In public, I'm going to define two constructors for distance. One is a default constructor in which I set feet is equal to 0, inch inches is equal to 0. Okay. And then I can have a parameterized constructor where I will get the value of feet and inch. Okay, where I set the value of the private variable feet is equal to ft, set the value of private variable inches is equal to inch. Okay, and then I'll have one more function in which I'll say you should display the distance. Display distance. And when I do, I say cout feet is equal to ft. Then I put in a new line inches is equal to inches. Okay, so feet is actually equal to ft. This is my program. Now, in the main function, I am going to declare a object of distance, which is called as d1, which passes two values, 11 and 10. Okay, this is first object. This is object number 1. And I am declaring another object, d2, which is -5, 11. This just cannot be negative, but just for the sake of programming, I'm just putting. So this is object number 2. Fine. Now, so if I compile this, I miss an I. And miss a semicolon. I don't want a bracket. I missed a semicolon. Distance is ambiguous. Let me do one thing. Let me just replace distance with capital distance. Okay, fine. So it is combined properly. So when I do this object creation, it will call this constructor. These are two different constructors, default and parameterized. Then we have seen in the last class, just 1 hour back, and it will initialize the values. Now, if I want to say, make all the values negative. So for example, in distance D1, I'm saying feet is 11 and inch is 10. I want to make this as negative. So what I'm going to do is, I'm going to say minus D1. Okay, I'm just saying minus D1, where D1 is the object here. What does a minus D1 for an object specify? That we haven't defined. So for that, we are going to define an overloading for minus operator. Okay, so how will you do that? You first say the class name operator, and you specify which operator, minus and in bracket. Okay, and then in this one you say my new value of feet is equal to negative of my old value, my new value of inches is equal to negative of my old value. Okay, and you return distance of feet, comma, this. Okay, this is how you overload. So let's see how this actions are happening. Okay, let's compile. Okay, so let's debug. So when I go to this, it will first go to parameters constructor. It will set the value of feet and inches, 11 and 10 comes out. It will create the new object called as D2. And for this also, it will create a new value for feet and inches, minus 5 and 11. So if I add b1.a, b1.feet, it is 11, b1.inches, it is 10, b2.feet, it is minus 5, b2.inches is equal to 11. So this is what it is already set. So when I do minus d1, okay, and if I go to the next line, you see that it went into this function. This is the operator overloading function. When you say minus b1, and if you specify a function which says there's a class name, there's an operator keyword and a minus, it will go to that function. And if I go into the function, and turn back, you see that the value of feet and inches has negated. Means previously it was 11 and 10, now it became minus 11 and minus 10. Okay, so when you did this, you see that it went into the parameterized constructor, assigned the value of the new feet and new inches to the old feet and old inches, which means it is negated and returned back. Okay, this is called as the operator overloading of unary operator. Okay, so you can have here, instead of minus, you can have plus. In that case, here it will be plus. And you can define what this should do here. Okay, you can say plus means a feet plus 10, for example. And inches means inches plus 10. Okay, so it will add 10 whenever you say plus d1. And it the new values of feet and inches for d1 will be whatever the old value plus 10. Okay, so that is how the operator overloading for unary operator works. Fine, but the important thing is you should define a function for operator overloading which consists of the class name, the operator name, operator keyword, and the operator name. Okay, fine. Now this is for unary operator. What about binary operator? Okay, so binary operator means that, for example, it is plus. Let me write a new code for this. Okay, so you are going to overload binary operator. Example, plus, minus, multiplication, division, etc. So let me define a class called as complex. Okay, it has two private variables, which is having int real and imaginary. Those are the private variables. And I have a constructor called as complex, which accepts two values, r and I. And I will assign real is equal to r, imaginary is equal to I. Okay. And I will just have another function called as print, which will print the real and imaginary values. Void print and I will see out real is equal to r, sorry, real. In new line, I have imaginary is equal to image. Okay. Now, I am declaring a new object for complex, which is called as C1. And let me initialize it with 10 and 15. Okay. I'm creating another object called as C2. Let me initialize it with 2 and 4. Okay. Now, what I am going to do is I'm going to create a new object called as C3, which is C1 plus C2. So you are adding two objects, C1 and C2. Now, what do you mean by adding two objects, C1 and C2? Are you adding the variables? Are you adding the functions? Or are you adding the complete class? What do you mean by addition of objects? That you need to specify by using an operator overloading function. Okay, so what you do is you have the class name, the operator keyword, plus, then you say you are accepting an argument of type object. by reference, and then you create a temporary variable called as result. Okay, then you say result dot real is equal to real plus object dot real. I'll explain what this is. And result dot imaginary is equal to imaginary plus object dot imaginary. Then you say return result. Okay, let me explain this. When you call C3 is equal to C1 plus C2, C2 is passed to the object. So C2 object dot real means this is actually C2 dot real. Object dot imaginary means it is actually C2 dot imaginary. Okay, this is actually C2 dot real. And this is actually C2 dot imaginary. So then what is this real and image? This is actually your first operand of plus, which is C1. This is actually C1 dot real, and this is C1 dot imaginary. Okay, so this is equivalent of saying C3 is equal to C1 dot operator of C2. This statement is equivalent to C3 is equal to C1 dot operator of C2, in which the operator function is called of the object C1 and passed C2 here. Okay, and you add C1 dot real plus C2 dot real in a new variable of class complex real and image, and then you return this class. Okay, so this res value will be copied to C3. C3 is of complex, res is of complex, so you can copy the values, new real and imaginary values, to C3. So C3 dot real will be res dot real, and C3 dot imaginary will be res dot imaginary, because you are returning res after this operation to C3. Okay, so let me just run this and show you. Let's put a break, compile, semicolon. There is no matching call for complex res. Let me see it. Okay, because I haven't created a constructor for this, let me create a constructor. Okay, now this is the first statement. Let me debug this. So when I go into this function, it has called the parameterized constructor. The real and imaginary part will be now C1 dot real is 10 and C1 dot imag is 15. Fine. If I go into the next object, real and imaginary will again be initialized. So C2 dot real is 2 and C2 dot imag is 4. Fine. Now, when I run this, the next statement, you see that it went into the complex operator plus, because there is a overloading for plus operation, and your the statement will execute from right to left. Okay, now when I into the function, it has called the constructor for this because you are creating an object of complex here. And let me add c3.real and c3.image. Okay, it has not been executed here because you are still executing this part. Okay, into the function. Now, when you return the result, which is of type complex itself, it will copy the values of rest to c3. You can see it from here. So you have added 10 plus 2, 12, 15 plus 4, 19, and the rest, when you return, the value is copied to c3, and you have added two objects. Okay, so this is called as operator overloading of binary operators. So instead of plus, let's say I have a minus here. Okay, so in that case, you need to create an operator overloading for minus. And in that minus, I can do anything inside this function. But for the sake of programming, I just subtract real and imaginary. So in that case, now the C3 will have a new real and imaginary value, which is the subtracted of C1 and C2. This is binary operator overload. Now, you can do binary operator overloading with friend functions also. So instead of using this like this, I can say that I have a friend function, this complex operator minus. Instead of object 1 and 2, object, you need to create two objects. This is called as object 1, comma this. Okay. And you copy this outside. And you don't want this. And here you say object 2. And here you say object 1. So when you are using the friend functions, you need to have two input arguments, object 1 and object 2. And then you need to access the arguments, variables of the arguments and copy this. Why this is happening? Because when you call C1 minus C2 with a friend function, C1 will be passed to object 1 and C2 will be passed to object 2. Okay. So this is complex okay, so let's debug this once again. Let's just put it here. And debug. Okay, so once it comes here, and if you go to into function, it will go into this friend function, this operator minus, and into the function, you see object.real is actually your 10, which is c1.real, and object2.real is actually your c2.real. Both are same, okay? Because you have copied the values of c2 to object 2 and c1 to object 1, okay? And then if you go in and if you return, the c3 now will be 10 minus 2. Let me do this. 10 minus 2, which is 8. 15 minus 4, which is 5. Okay. So that's how you can overload a minus operator. You can, the thing you should notice, you can do anything inside this function. You can change the what minus sign means using this. It is possible. But usually you never do that. You will do operator overloading for very basic purpose only. Okay, so that is regarding operator overload. Okay, so let me show my slides. Unary operators are plus plus, minus minus, and minus, etc. So you have some questions here. This is constructor one, default constructor. This is constructor two, parameterized constructor. This is where you are creating an object in which the parameters constructor will be called. This we have done in the program. And this is the operator overloading unary minus operator. So when you say minus d1, this function is called. And when you say minus d2, again this function is called. Okay, this is operator overloading. So you see inside the function, we are creating minus feet and minus inches. Now for overloading binary operators, you create a class called as complex, which has a parameterized constructor called as complex, which takes in the values for R and I, assigning to the values. And then you create an operator plus, whenever you say C3 is equal to C1 plus C2, this function will be called. Okay, and the minus operator is being overloaded, and this are some exercises. Now you can also overload using friend functions. You can see that friend complex operator plus complex. Actually, this is obj1, and there is one more parameter obj2. Okay, I'll correct that. And you can create the function outside the class. Whenever it says c1 plus c2, the friend function will be called. Now you have a homework in which using the operator overloading, you concatenate two strings. For example, if the string is two strings are, let's say, I and am, using this plus operator, you should say I am. Okay, that is your homework, and you have some questions at the end so that you can check what that is. Okay, so that's all regarding operator overloading. Let me see the syllabus, how far we have reached. Okay, I think we have almost done. Okay, so we have finished half of module number two, and then we have another called as inheritance, which we will take in the next class. Inheritance is also a concept of object-oriented programming. Okay, but we will take it in the next class. So if you have any doubts regarding whatever we have thought today, let me know. Okay. Anybody have any doubts? You can tell. Okay, so let's go to attendance. PC one. One,
two.
Okay.
Three absent, four.
Okay.
Five.
Okay.
Six.
Okay.
Seven.
Okay. Eight. Nine.
Sorry, eight.
Okay. Nine. Okay.
Nine absent, ten.
Okay.
11.
Okay. 12.
13.
Okay.
14.
Okay.
15.
Okay.
16.
Okay. 70.
18.
Okay.
19.
Okay.
20.
Okay.
21.
Okay.
22.
Okay.
23.
Okay.
24.
Okay.
25.
Okay. 26.
27.
Okay. 28. 29.
30.
Okay.
31.
Okay.
32.
Okay.
33.
Okay.
34.
Okay.
35.
Okay.
36.
Okay.
37.
Okay. 38.
39.
Okay.
40.
Okay.
41.
Okay.
42.
Okay. 43.
44.
Okay.
45.
Okay.
46.
Okay. 47. 48. Okay.
49.
50.
49%.
50.
Ah, fine. Okay.
51.
Okay.
Okay.
53.
Okay.
54.
Okay.
55.
Okay. 56.
57.
Okay.
59.
Right. 59. Okay.
EC2. 1.
Okay.
2.
Okay.
3.
Okay. 4. Okay.
4.
Okay.
5.
5.
5.
Okay.
6.
Okay. 7.
8.
Okay. 9. 10.
11.
Okay.
13.
Okay. 14.
16.
Okay.
17.
Okay.
18.
Okay.
19.
Okay.
20.
Okay. 21.
22.
Okay. 21, 22, 23.
24.
Okay.
25.
Okay.
26.
Okay.
27.
Okay. 28.
29.
Okay.
30.
Okay.
31.
Okay.
32.
Okay.
33.
Okay.
34.
Okay.
25.
Okay.
36.
Okay.
37.
Okay.
39.
Okay.
40.
40. 40.
Okay.
41.
Okay.
41.
42.
Okay. 43. 44.
45.
Okay.
46.
Okay.
48.
Okay.
49.
Okay.
50.
Okay.
51.
Okay.
52.
Okay. 53.
54.
Okay.
55.
Okay.
56.
Okay.
57.
Okay.
58.
Okay.
59.
Okay.
60.
Okay.
61.
Okay. 62. 63. Okay. Fine. So, thank you for tolerating me for next. Yeah.
23.
Okay. പിന്നെ
ആരാണ്
Okay, fine. So, thank you for listening, for tolerating for 2 hours. Yeah, so we'll meet again next Wednesday. Thank you all.